Good evening and a warm welcome to another session in the series of meeting an expert. Today indeed is going to be a very interesting, very timely discussion, and I'm sure all of you will benefit very well out of this session today, having been listened to him in different perspectives. So to start off with the day, I would like to warmly welcome all our students who are in the platform today, joining us from Apid family, and of course all our students and colleagues who are joining us from our counterpart universities, and all our delegates who are joining us from all around the world, and finally all the other distinguished guests who are in the platform as well. So we are going live on both platforms, one being in the Zoom platform where the webinar is posted, and in the social media platforms as well. So I would like to request all of you, you have the chat lines open for you to send in your questions and your expressions. We always welcome that. So having said that, I would like to now invite our chairman, Mr. Bandulai Godage, chairman of Apid Sri Lanka, just to share his expressions before we start off for the day. Chairman, over to you.
Thank you, Kaushali, and it's a great honor and privilege today, actually, on behalf of our CEO Roshana Godage and also the board of directors, entire APIT student population, and the diplomatic society who is joining today for this webinar, and also the people or our loving parents, the students, and also the teachers. On behalf of them, I would like to welcome Mr. Rajiv Bandaranaike, CEO of our today, the chief guest for today's webinar. In spite of busy schedule, he kindly accepted the great initiative created by Dr. Rohanthas to help our students, especially to express his views. I'm sure it will definitely give us a different dimension to whole exercise. For your information, Rajiv, we have been doing this as the CEO's forum. And we want to bring different aspects into our students to get their direct intervention with you, people like you, like opinion leaders like you, for them to have their, for expansion of their knowledge. So you will be, you will agree with me, during our childhood that we didn't have this sort of interaction with so big people. So we are fortunate enough to give that opportunity to our student population to mingle with you, directly interact with you, and to get your opinion and to shine off their experience also during their student life. And you know, the APIT as the quality education sector, we ensure the academic excellence for all our students, but we need to go beyond that one extra mile. That is, and we want to build the leadership, and we want to have our students to be all-round people. So to have that one and to serve the purpose to the society, we have decided to bring people like you. So this is the whole objective of this exercise, thanks to Dr. Rohanta once again. So our CEO and the board of directors are very keen on giving the purpose and all giving some value for the entire thing. So value-based education. Purpose-based education, therefore we are driving the very value-driven concept and also the effort. So once again, in spite of busy schedule and people are talking, this is the talk of the town also. So I once again thank you for Rajiv being with us, and all the very best. Over to you, Dr. Rohanta and Kaushali, to continue with the webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Chairman. And it's actually fantastic to have the chairman of the Industrial Association of Sri Lanka, vice president of Nestle, and of course the chairman of APIT. So Rajiv Bandaranaike, chief executive officer, Colombo Stock Exchange. Mr. Bandaranaike has been serving as the CEO of the Colombo Stock Exchange since 2013. He has served in many senior positions, capacity at the stock exchange in trading, clearing and settlement, branch development, marketing, human resources, and has given leadership to several market development initiatives. He has also served as the chief executive officer of two listed companies and accounts for a total of 30 years plus experience in financial services. Mr. Bandaranaike holds a degree in Law LLB from the Open University of Sri Lanka, a master's in business administration from the University of Southern Queensland, Australia, a postgraduate diploma in marketing from Chartered Institute of Marketing, UK, and a stockbroker certificate from Securities and Institute of Australia. I mean, a person who is right now the man on the hot seat, the stock exchange going at another record level of 9,500 plus. Rajiv, over to you. And thank you so much, sir, for coming and giving your very valuable time. It's actually an honor to see you, my good friend from Rotary. I've been knowing you for so many years, and I'm actually honored, sir, to have you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. And a very good evening to all of you. The chairman, Mr. Ekodage, of course, my good friend, Dr. Rohanta Atukoral, whose invitation I simply couldn't refuse. Kaushali for starting off the session today, and of course, all of you who are tuned in today and logged in. So it's a pleasure to be here at APIT and to share a few perspectives. And when Dr. Atukoral did ask me, let's give it a kind of dimension to the market, and let's connect it to the pandemic as well. So appropriately, we have titled it Overcoming the Pandemic from a Market Perspective. So I'll share some thoughts in that direction. I hope you can sort of see the screen. So let's put things into perspective first. Good to have a recap, nothing that you don't know, but just to recap where we are in terms of the global environment. As you know, globally, the global economy has shrunk during the 2019-2020 period, but the projections are that it'll bounce back and grow in 2021. The loss has been estimated. Of course, these can differ, but it's a significant loss to the global economy as well. And if you look at Sri Lanka, it's no different. We also suffered. You know that our economy contracted. But again, I think we are in positive territory in 2021. If you look at the environment itself, all of us know and understand very well that the growth challenge faced by Sri Lanka is immense. And the pandemic has affected us in more than in one way. The slowing down of global trade, particularly tourism, I think has impacted us, because that's something that not only creates direct employment, but also a lot of indirect employment that is not even counted, and revenue that is not counted. So it has a ripple effect to all strata of society in Sri Lanka. There were some progressive policies that were planned, but unfortunately, I think some of these could not be implemented as a result. And so therefore, it has an overall damping impact. And we are seeing that today. So we need a vibrant comeback to some of the core sectors that have been affected, for us also to get out of this rut. So that's just to provide some kind of background as to where we are, and we need to be very realistic about this. And I think I need to make a comment that it is not only Sri Lanka who is impacted. Go across many countries, there are lots of countries who have very similar problems, a lot of countries who are still struggling with the pandemic, and we have seen a lot of a blame game on how we handle the pandemic. But I think we are no better or worse than most of the countries in dealing with it. In fact, I think where our vaccinations and all are concerned, we're doing pretty well. So that's just the background. So let us steer now into our conversation into stock markets and capital markets. Again, this is not something that you probably don't know, but again, good to recap why capital markets are important. So one is it provides an avenue for the private sector to raise capital, and I'll talk a little bit about that. But particularly this year, how the primary market of the stock market has picked up, and how companies are effectively using the market to raise funds. Secondly, again, avenue for government also to borrow funds, and I'll again share a little perspective into that, how government can effectively use the stock market in a much more effective manner than what they're using. Again, in terms of foreign investment, the potential to attract foreign investment, badly needed dollars into the country. Of course, it again creates wealth for people, create wealth for shareholders, because with capital appreciation, your wealth, your personal wealth increases, the wealth of shareholders of companies. So creates employment opportunities and therefore promotes economic growth and adds to the GDP of the country. It certainly helps to lower cost of capital. It also provides a good diversification opportunity for investors, both foreign and local. And of course, above all, it also promotes sound governance practices among companies, better disclosure, more transparency, accountability, and overall better governance where companies are concerned. So there are a lot of benefits in a properly operating stock market if both the state sector and the private sector harnesses the full potential of the capital market or the stock market. So countries have done it differently, and I'll also give some statistics on that to give you an indication how well countries are effectively using their capital markets. It's there to be utilized, and I think the success of a capital market is how well the stakeholders use those stock markets for their benefit. So just to put you into perspective, stock market institutions are known as capital market infrastructure providers. That is, stock exchange will provide the infrastructure for all this to happen. So globally, there are about 250 recognized institutions. We have three here. What are the three? Stock exchange, and we have two repositories. The stock exchange has our own central depository to maintain the share portfolios of investors. Then the central bank has their own depository for government security. So we have three such institutions here. If we talk about listed companies, there are about 48,000 listed companies, and in Sri Lanka, we have 285. If you look at the market capitalization, globally, it's over $100 trillion. But in Sri Lanka, we are a relatively small market, and our market capitalization currently, it's gone from 18, now it's about nearly $22 billion in terms of size. So that's how you generally measure the size of a stock market. Just to give you a perspective of where we are ranked globally, you know, stock markets are categorized according to developed markets, emerging markets, frontier markets, and standalone markets. So Sri Lanka is classified as a frontier market. We have not graduated on the emerging markets yet. And in Asia, we are bunched together with Bangladesh and Vietnam. So when we are competing for foreign funds, we are in fact competing with Bangladesh and Vietnam for funds. Because when global fund managers allocate funds, they generally allocate according to these categories and these sectors. So when they allocate to Asia, they look at these three countries together and then apportion it. So our closest competitors are those two countries as well. And of course, you have the big fish in the emerging markets, Asian emerging markets like Thailand, Philippines, Malaysia, Korea, Indonesia, etc. So our next target will be at someday when the economy does well to progress to be classified as an emerging market in Asia. So that's the long-term goal. So today I like to talk a little bit about the pandemic and how it has affected the market, and to share some thoughts as to how we have done certain things to overcome the challenges that have been posed by the pandemic. There are three key challenges for the stock market currently, even though it's the in thing now and a very hot topic, certainly very active, providing good returns to investors. But there are three key challenges. One is the pandemic and its impact to society and economy, and the how well the economy performs is has a direct impact on how the stock market also would perform in the long run, because the companies that operate in that economy are the ones that are listed and that those shares are traded. Second is about attracting foreign investment. You know the difficulties that we are facing with regard to foreign, both direct and portfolio. So a key second challenge is how do we attract foreign investors back into the country? And thirdly, both managing the exchange rate. And again, I think I needn't dwell upon the challenges that have been posed with regard to the exchange rate. But if you look at opportunities, there are abundance of really opportunities. One is the potential to increase our size and liquidity. Our market is still small. There's room to grow, unlike some of the other stock markets which are saturated. Liquidity, there's room to grow liquidity. We are in a low interest rate environment. So therefore, there is opportunity for equities to do well. So we have seen a shift in investors moving their money from fixed income to equity. Valuations are attractive, which I will show you in a moment. There are strong corporate earnings growth. In the last two quarters, we have had record earnings reported by listed companies, which has strengthened the case for equity investments. Market also provides a good diversification opportunities. About 20 plus sectors are represented. So you have opportunity to diversify your investment into diverse sectors, so that when one sector is not doing very well, you can still earn good returns from another sector. We have been continuously improving our market infrastructure, and I don't know if I'll have time for that, but I can, if we do have time, we can take some discussion about how we are trying to do some new products as well. Again, SMEs is another focus area, and we have seen a very good interest among SMEs to raise capital through a public market. And I will again share, two companies have already opted to take that route. And of course, the digitization initiative, which has enabled greater accessibility and opportunity for anybody from any part of Sri Lanka to really enter the stock market without really having the need to physically visit any bank or stockbroker office. So that convenience and accessibility is now being offered as well. So if you can see, abundance of opportunity, even though there are the challenges. So I think we are looking at this very positively and trying to overcome the challenges by leveraging on the opportunities that we have, and then drawing on the strengths in order to address some of the challenges that we do face. And as we go on, we can discuss that a little further. So just to give you a snapshot, as you know, we have seen a negative growth. This is just to articulate what I said in my previous slide to illustrate it more clearly. Needless to say, the US dollar depreciation that we are seeing, the rupee depreciation that we are seeing, the exchange rate, which has been a bone of contention right now. Decreasing foreign direct investments, again, a cause for concern, and the need to rejuvenate. We know that the BOI is on a complete revamping exercise to re-canvas some of the foreign direct investment opportunities, and I think they have a good pipeline as well. Again, another concern is about the foreign outflows from the stock market. It's a fact that there have been outflows, but again, this is a cyclical thing. Just a quick comment on this foreign outflows. Sri Lanka has been fortunately experiencing foreign inflows for portfolio investment, equity investment from the early 1990s. And we have a very good base of foreign portfolio investors who like the country, who understand the country, who are comfortable investing in these listed companies. But there are times where this money flows in and out. And even though we have seen outflow, we needn't be unduly worried, because this has been a trend from 2018 among Asian markets, where funds have flown back into safe havens in US and UK. But I think it's a matter of time before they come back, and they do eventually come back, and we have seen several cycles of that. But we need to manage the outflows right now. So since we need the foreign investors coming in, but right now, we have seen a trend where there have been foreign investors exiting the market. Fortunately, with each negative, we see a positive as well. So when foreigners started leaving, the foreign investor contribution, the market was as high as 44%. Now it has dropped to 8%. But what we have seen with the lowering of the interest rates in 2020 and 2021, with the low interest rate regime, we have seen a whole host of local individual investors and institutional investors who have opted to shift their portfolios from fixed income securities into the equity market. And we have seen as a result a spurt and a reactivation of the market. So in order to compensate for some of the foreign outflows, we have seen a rejuvenation of the equity market among the local investors. And that has fueled both liquidity, volumes, and also created demand, which has driven up the indices and the prices, as you can see, all the activity in the market. So I think in a sense, it is good timing that we have had another category of investors coming into the market when one category leaves. So this is this is very cyclical, as you said, and there will come a time where the foreigners come back into the market, and perhaps the local investors will take a back seat again and go back to fixed income securities when the rates do move up. And today, in fact, if you look at the treasury bill market today, the figures that we just received, we are seeing the rates also moving up somewhat. For example, a one-year treasury bill has moved up from 6.50 to 7.01, which is a bit of a jump in a sense. So we have seen a trend in rates also moving up. So this is cyclical and ever changing. So this is not something that we should be unduly worried about, but typical of the market conditions and the fluctuations that we are seeing. So what are the opportunities that interest rates provided? I'm just providing an illustration here of the turn in the interest rates, which has fueled the investment in stock market. And before I get to any of the other numbers per se, I like to share this slide with you, which is quite interesting to show the trajectory of the market. Now, this is the All Share Price Index, which is indicated in this slide. From 1990 up to about 2009, the market index moved from about 1,000 to 2,500 or 3,000 points. So it was within that band. There were fluctuations in between, but it was within that band. Post-war, that's 2009, it has moved to a different level of operating. So we have now moved to an 8,000 level in the index. So we have clearly seen that the 30 years of war has stifled the market to a large extent, and it sort of broke free thereafter. Of course, there have been the volatility connected typically with Asian markets, but if you really observe that we are now on a totally different trajectory where the market is concerned, and we need to now see what measures we can take as a country, as a market, as stakeholders to move the market further in a sustainable manner. So it's good to understand how the market is currently. So I did mention about another opportunity in terms of valuation. How attractive is our market? And if you compare our valuations in terms of price earnings with our peer countries, and this is something that foreign investors would look for, we are still attractive. Our PEs are still at 10.2 times or a little more in comparison to some of the other markets where the PEs are much higher, and comparative market is Pakistan. So when foreigners do allocate, when they do look at markets, they will certainly look at this aspect of whether the market is overvalued or is still attractive in terms of valuation. So this is another selling point that we have for foreign. So if you look at liquidity, so we measure liquidity with a measure called turnover velocity to indicate the liquidity or how active, how well the market is liquid. So the ease of entry and exit, can you enter and exit the market without impacting price too much? And we have seen this figure phenomenally climbing up in the last 2 to 3 years. It was 6% in 2019, almost doubled in 2020, and then again doubled again this year. So currently we are averaging over 4 billion rupees in terms of turnover for a day, coming from something like 40,000, 45,000 transactions. If you see the period prior to 2009, we were averaging just 1 billion rupees a day in terms of turnover, even less. I think in 2018, we were averaging 700 million a day and just 5,000 transactions. So the transactions almost grown tenfold. Some if days we are doing below 50,000 transactions a day, 40 to 50,000. So we have seen an increase in the number of transactions, the number of people participating in the market, the volumes as well. So there are growth indicators all around. Then another factor which we see as an opportunity is our market capitalization to GDP is only at 20%. So market is somewhat underrepresented in the overall sense in the economy, whereas if you look at some of our peer countries, like for example, Indonesia is 43%, Vietnam is at 87%, Thailand, India. So when you get to 100% level, you're somewhat saturated. So this is an opportunity to say that more companies are out there which are not listed. So there is opportunity for a lot more companies to come and get listed. And therefore, there is a huge growth opportunity for both investors as well as companies to grow with the market, because we are still at a growth stage. So the potential to grow is another factor they are considering. Again, this is a graphical illustration of the valuations at 10.8 times, of course, mid-2021. Another positive sign is that the dividend yield, we have quite a decent dividend yield, 2.99, which can be added to the returns of capital gains, which is comparatively better than some of our peer markets. We are doing better than India and some of the other countries in terms of dividend yield. So this is again another an opportunity. Just to give you a flavor of how the new accounts have been moving, again, we have seen a doubling and tripling of the number of new accounts per day. CDS accounts, those are new entrants coming in into the market. So currently averaging something like 140 applications a day, which is up from about 80, which we averaged last year. So there is a definite trend in the number of people who are coming into the market. And the good thing about this is that we are seeing a significant shift in the demographics of the people who are coming. Earlier, majority were 50 plus, mostly retirees who were in the stock market. But in the recent 1.5 to 2 years, we have seen a clear shift among a younger set of investors coming into the market. 80% of the new accounts that have been opened are below 40 years of age. So we see a very definitive trend, which is a very good sign, because we are seeing a younger set replacing the older generation of investors who are there. So they are actually more savvy. They are more better informed. They demand knowledge, information, etc. And also they are using technology. So in a sense, they are adding value to the market, because overall, they will demand better, higher quality services from stakeholders, from brokers. So we have to raise the bar from everywhere. You will find that stakeholders, service providers also will be raising the bar, because there is a demand coming from the market. There is demand for better research, demand for better information, demand for more timely information, demand for better technology, various technology options that people are demanding. So you will find that the standard of the market itself in terms of infrastructure and knowledge base will also improve with this. So it's a good shift that we are also seeing. Just to give you a quick flavor of the number of, we created a mobile app, and there has been again a phenomenal number of new downloads into the app in a very short space of time. So I like to get to the crux of the message today about the pandemic and how as a market we reacted and how we overcame. So when the first lockdown came in March, when there's a strict curfew imposed, the regulator came down hard on us and said, if there is no accessibility, you cannot operate the market, because you have to have a free and fair market. And as a result, with the curfew, we were compelled to close the market, totally close the market for 1.5 months, which is probably a worse thing to happen to any stock market, because you're infringing among the rights of shareholders to freely trade the share. But the curfew was unexpected, and we had no other choice but to close. So what we did during that period very quickly is that we ramped up all our systems, the infrastructure, both at the broker end, at the exchange end, and all the other market participants, and enabled when the market did open finally on the 11th of May, and when the second lockdown came on, we were able to operate the stock market completely remotely. So as an exchange, we operated remotely. We had that capacity, but we also provided that ability to every stockbroker firm to also operate remotely. We, for example, created or we upgraded the mobile app from a merely information portal to something much more, where anybody from any part of Sri Lanka, now we are enabling it even for foreigners, but initially we enabled it to Sri Lankans, where from any part of Sri Lanka, you could download the app, open an account, upload all your identification details, and then register yourself with the stockbroker, start trading, make your settlements, receive all your confirmation statements, etc., through that, and work in a completely digitalized environment. So when the second lockdown came, we in fact, as an industry, probably one of the few industries apart from the tea industry and some of the others, where we were able to operate completely remotely. And we did that quite successfully as a result of us getting pushed to completely work in a digitalized environment. And we had also some quick wins. For example, we signed up with the Registrar of Persons with the Identity Card Department, and that enabled us to perform the KYC in an eKYC format. So for the first time, stockbrokers were performing the KYC online in a digital format, and we provided access where they could download the identity card from the source, from the identity card office, get it on the screen, do a comparison, and then perform the eKYC, which enabled a seamless entry of investors into the market. We also enabled digital agreements to be signed, use the new regulations concerning digital signatures, and but investors digitally sign it, and then enable this remote working condition. So I think quite apart from the other factors that have helped the market to go where it did go to, we also saw the pandemic really pushing us to expedite some of the plans that we already had in terms of going digital and working remotely. The stock exchange, without anybody being in office, we can open the market, operate the market, and close it. And even stockbroker firms have the same ability as well now. So as a result, we are now ready to face any condition. And the beauty of it is that remote working, we are enabling 10 times the number of volumes and transactions as we were doing it physically. So I think the pandemic has taught us many things. It has brought out the best in people in coming up with very innovative solutions, responding to market requirements, and the results have been quite positive, to the extent that I did mention one result is that we are seeing a younger set of investors that have come into the market, etc. So it has resulted in a lot of positive outcomes as well, when you are really pushed to it. So this particular comment made by Bob Riley, who is in fact a US senator, a Democratic senator, who made this statement, of course, long time ago, not during pandemic times, when he said hard times don't create heroes. It is during the hard times that the hero within us is revealed. And I think that is very true in terms of our industry, where the regulator, Securities and Exchange Commission, spearheaded an initiative along with the exchange and the market, where they set up a joint committee and sat down and thought, how do we respond as an industry to overcome this challenge and operate in a manner that we never ever close the market or get into a situation where we cannot operate. So end of the day, as a result of this, we are now operating better than what we did because we have improved our processes, we have brought in better controls, we have upgraded our technology to better respond and act in a manner that ultimately we have facilitated investors and shareholders to enable them to make use of the market conditions. Now, we can see the kind of returns that the market has given. If you look at the index growth, I think our index has grown over 30% for this year. So the benefits accrue to the investor, and we are happy to have been able to create the right conditions to enable both investors and companies to benefit. So in closing, I would also like to make a quick mention about the listed companies and the activation of the primary market. So as a result of all this activity, as a result of the demand for capital, we have seen a reactivation of the primary market, meaning companies are now coming forward more than before to raise capital using the stock market, which is again a very good sign because that provides a good opportunity for new investors also to giving them new avenues of opportunity apart from the current listed companies. So for this year, we have already seen 30 new issues, both debt, equity, private placements, rights issues, etc. And we have really been able to facilitate nearly 100 billion rupees in capital. I think we have raised about 95 billion rupees in facilitated that amount of money being raised through the market. And I think end of the year, we will surpass the 100 billion very easily. Last year, we were able to facilitate 66 billion worth of new capital. But we have even surpassed that, and there is a good pipeline of new issues that are coming to raise capital. And the other good factor is that we are also seeing the SME sector now looking at public markets. And we saw after creating a separate new board for SME companies to encourage SME companies to solve some of their capital issues, we saw two new listings taking place in the SME, the Empower board or the SME board as well. So across the board, we are seeing the large, the medium, and the small size companies making use of the market. And more recently, we were able to very successfully negotiate with the central bank, who amended their foreign exchange regulations to permit local companies now to come and raise US dollar denominated debt and equity. And those regulations are just published. We are awaiting the SEC's regulatory rule approvals. And once that comes through, we will also see local companies coming into the market and raising capital in US dollar terms. So export-oriented companies who have dollar exposures also will have a new opportunity. So in a sense, this has created a lot of opportunities in the market and helped to rejuvenate the primary market as well. So I think my 30 minutes is up. We'd like to leave some time for any questions. So with that comment, I will stop and hand you back over to Dr. Rohant.
Thank you very much, Rajiva. Excellent overview of what's happening in the market and how we are going to look at it. I mean, got a whole heap of questions coming in from different people, and I'm getting also questions coming on my WhatsApp. The first question that they're asking you is that it's Gayan, who works, I think, at Brandix, in one of our MBA, on the MBA program. He's asking, what is the percentage of the economy reflected in the stock exchange? I think you mentioned 20%. Why is it so low in Sri Lanka?
Yes, let me try to get to that slide. All right, I hope you can see this. So this is a representation of how well what importance the market assumes in the overall economy. Now, what we must understand is our stock exchange in its present stage has a 35-year history. So sometimes perhaps not well ingrained into the system, as against India, which has a probably history of about 100 years. So, and also the second factor is we have undergone probably a 30-year protracted war, which really stifled the market. And I think that was one major, major factor, which really stifled the growth in the market. And I think I showed you how the index trajectory works. And it's very clear from there as how saturated the market was at that time, where nothing really much happened and there was no growth opportunity at all created. And it is only when a country experiences probably a sustained economic growth of about 5 years at least, that there is a demand for capital. Companies start growing and then their internally generated funding becomes inadequate or not enough. And then they have to reach out to public markets. So it's at that stage that companies will start going out to markets, capital markets, to for their funding requirements. Otherwise, in a era where the country is not growing at a fast pace, their internal generated funding and their bank funding is more than adequate to for their expansion. But it is only when they expand at a rate higher than that that you really need to go to capital markets. And if you look at some of the other countries, I think economically all of them have performed better, and that's why you have their markets better represented rather than our market. So that's one major factor. So it's not for any want of probably lack of marketing or lack of knowledge on the part of companies that there is a mechanism like this. For example, I think all of the corporate sector today have very good accountants, finance people to advise them, and they are well versed with the different avenues open to raise capital. So it's just that I think the conditions have to be right for those companies to come in and list, and we're seeing that shift happening now.
It's a very interesting question, Rajiva, from Krishan. He's actually based in Dubai, but he's doing the masters at Staffordshire. And he's saying, right, why are the top companies, like the top apparel companies, the largest tea companies, not in the stock market?
Yeah, good question, and thank you for asking that. Now, if you look at the Sri Lankan companies, we did a research to find out as to why companies are not listing here. So there are a number of factors. One key reason would be, again, going back to your economic growth story, is about valuations. So when a company decides to list, the company is giving up some part of the independence and freedom, because you're going into public markets, you have certain obligations cast on you, you have compliance requirements, you're giving up part of your shareholding, that you're giving up part of your wealth. So what is in it for the shareholders, the owners of the company in return? So they want a good valuation. And again, Sri Lanka, as I showed you, from an investor point of view, the valuations are attractive because it's low. But for a company owner, he or she will want a good price for the share. And it is only when that company feels that they can get an adequate price that they will be encouraged to come and divest part of their company. Because they value a company and they have built up maybe a company over generations for a long time. So they want the best price for the company. And it is only when the valuations are attractive that companies will seek a listing in the first instance. And we are seeing this with the growth in the indices, with the growth in the prices in the market. We are seeing now renewed interest among companies to take listing. And that's why we are having a lot of new listings here. So one reason. Second reason is there is this perceived loss of control factor, particularly among Sri Lankan companies, where most of them are family held. So they feel that if they do part of their shareholding, they will lose control. So this factor of fear of losing control is also very relevant in their eyes. And the third thing, other ancillary reasons, like, for example, the level of transparency and accountability that comes with the listing obligation, the compliance requirements, the disclosure requirements. In fact, some of them have said that when you're in a competitive business, if your competitors are not listed and you are listed, will I be at a disadvantage because I need to disclose my financials to all of other material information and competitors will make use of that information. So there are perceived fears among owners, some perceived, not real fears. So in our marketing efforts, really that's what we try to address with those companies, that these are mostly perceptions and those are not real issues, but the advantages heavily outweigh the negatives that you have in terms of listing. So there are a number of factors that have made some of the companies that Sri Lanka has, some of the larger companies, still not getting a listing. So Ridhan, I mentioned some of the key ones, key reasons.
Raju, there's a question coming from Lalindra. He says, what's the industry making good profit and in proper place to invest? What is your advice?
I can't give any investment advice. One thing, I'm not an investment advisor and I don't extend nothing, although I'm in the thick of it. I'm probably one of the worst advisors because I don't follow individual stocks. But best is that you do seek advice from investment advisor of stockbroker firm. But if you look at the market, you have diverse sectors, about 20 different sectors that are represented in more ways than one. And right now, this is again cyclical. If you asked me 3 years back, some of the growth sectors are really banking, diversified industries, etc., who were really thriving and doing well. But now you see a shift. You see a shift into logistics companies, etc., doing very well. Because they have been, their revenue streams have been very good in terms of the pandemic, because they are moving in logistics business has earned them better revenues. And you find that companies in tourism, leisure, etc., are taking a beating, and therefore their revenues have really fallen and not made very good investments to be considered. So you have different sectors playing different roles. Banking has always traditionally been a good sector to invest in. Right now it's a bit saturated, but we have seen the logistic companies particularly performing quite well in the current context.
Raju, there's a question coming. I think he's an entrepreneur. And he's studying for the masters at Staffordshire, and he's asking, why don't we have a stock market only for the SMEs?
Yeah, so what we did was we have created a separate listing board for SME called Empower Board. Now that is specifically tailored for SME companies, because the requirements, the criteria for listing is very different to the larger and the medium sized companies. So the entry requirements are those which have been very carefully drafted in a manner that it fits an SME company. Secondly, the listing obligations also have been drafted in such a manner that it is easy for those companies to maintain a listing. It's not very expensive on one hand. And secondly, it's not as onerous as the listing requirements for a larger listed company, which will enable a small SME company also on one hand to make use of the market, raise capital, but yet in a cost-effective manner, maintain the listing. The third thing we have done is we have created an institution called a sponsor institution, where the sponsor institution will do a hand-holding exercise for the SME, because the SME company may not have the same wherewithal like a larger bank or a company for compliance reasons, for continued listing obligations. So this sponsor institution, for a very nominal fee, will work with the particular SME company to bring it on board, to advise the company, bring it to the market, and do a hand-holding exercise for 2 years so that they will help the company to maintain the listing and to conform to all the listing obligations and the rules and the regulations to make it very easy for the company. So even if it's a small entity which does not have all the structures of independent directors, compliance officers, you still can manage to obtain and maintain a listing. And 2 companies have already done that successfully. Again, where the rules are considered, we have come up with very different criteria for even governance requirements. For example, all the subcommittee requirements, etc. We have amalgamated and allowed 1 audit committee to kind of perform all the different functions of a board levels, other subcommittees as well. So like that, a lot of concessions have been made. Again, where financial statements are concerned, you can still continue to submit the SME standard of submitting accounts according to the SLAS MB standards. So you don't have to go to IFRS accounting as well. They are permitted for the first 3 years to go on the same accounting, SME accounting standards. So a lot of concessions have been provided to encourage those SME companies to come. And there's a dedicated board for that. It's available on our website. And you could really download all of that information. And there are contact people who will contact and help you to do. If you're interested in listing, they'll help you to do that as well.
Interesting question coming up. What made you get involved in this sector as a career? When many would, with your background, join multinationals and blue chips. Very interesting.
Yeah. See, I was initially attracted. I joined the stock exchange into the depository. At the time, they were setting up the depository, which is something very new. And what really motivated me was I was working for a, of course, profit-oriented companies in the private sector. And when I did see this, what really struck me was this is an opportunity for me to do something for the economy and the country. So you are not really serving a particular group of shareholders and to create wealth for them. But here you'll be joining an institution which will help to create wealth for probably a larger segment of people, for investors, for companies, for everyone. And that was a really attractive proposition as against working for a purely private sector profit-oriented company. It gave a higher purpose. And I think that was one defining reason for me to do this shift. So I think primary reason, and thereon it really attracted me because the potential I have grown with the institution. And if you look at what we had in 1992 when I joined and what we have today, when you look back, you can be proud that I have had the opportunity of being part of a transition of a market from where we were to what we are today in terms of market infrastructure, in terms of the quality of the companies that have come in terms of the quality of the market intermediaries, in terms of the products that are coming out, etc. So it has been very fulfilling to that extent because you are serving, as I said, and be part of creating wealth for people. And it's a nice feeling to know that you're facilitating a lot of people to create wealth for themselves. So I think that's fulfillment in a way.
A nice question is coming up. She's saying the only positive news we have right now in Sri Lanka happens to be the stock exchange. And for a youngster like me, when I see the irregularity of decision making by government authorities and the health issues in the country, and of course the foreign exchange issue, what advice would you give me?
Yeah, well, it's like this. First of all, I think we must not rush to condemn those in authority. I'm not part of any political party. I'm completely independent, and we are a private sector organization as well. So, you know, I have no affiliations. But I think it's not an easy job running a country. We know what a difficult job it is to run an organization. You can imagine the kind of headaches that you have when you're running sort of country with so many different pressures that you experience. So pandemic has created challenges for everyone, even globally. And I think countries, leaders are still trying to grapple with it. And I think to compound and to make matters worse, we have, I think, a very, very long history of really not getting our act together as a country in terms of how we handle our finances. And I think it has all come at a time where the pandemic also has hit, and we have all these exchange, foreign exchange challenges, coupled with liquidity issues, price controls, and all of it. So, I mean, that's part and parcel of developing countries like probably Sri Lanka. And I think the way I see it is that, as I outlined in the slide, let's do what we can. I mean, there are challenges, and I'm a person, as I said, I'm not politically affiliated, but I don't look at the negatives, but try to see what we can do to make life better for our stakeholders and in the industry that we are in, and to maximize our resources in a manner that it will really help the country broadly as well, and even our industry. And that's our single focus as an industry, as a market, as an institution. And that's what we have been doing. We have been looking after the welfare of our staff. We have done a lot for our staff. We have had our share of problems. We even lost a staff member through COVID. We had one of our software heads, he died of COVID. We had our share of COVID casualties. So we have stretched out and helped our staff to overcome it to various programs and initiatives. We even had collected money and donated a lot of medical equipment to hospitals around the country. So we did a lot of what we could. The second part of your question about, yes, the only good thing that is happening, I wouldn't say the only good thing. There are industries that are doing well. Of course, when you look at a stock market, there are the risks. It's not a one-way street. There are the risks associated with investing in stock markets. And I think it's very important to learn, to understand how to manage those risks and overcome those risks. So share prices can drop as much as they can go up. So it's very important to identify companies correctly. For that, you need to invest not only money, but also invest time in learning about the company, learning about the market, learning about market risk, that there are capital losses as well as capital gains. So it's not something that it's all nice and great to see the indices moving and the prices moving, but markets are volatile and there are ups and downs in the market, and you need to be very mindful of that. So you need to be very careful if you are thinking of entering the market as an investor. You need to do so under guidance with proper advice as well. If you are looking at the market as a career, I think it's a very good place that I can recommend. There are abundance of opportunity within the market as a career, because you're not only looking at the stock exchange and the stock brokers, but there's an entire ecosystem in the capital markets. You have investment banks, you have margin providing companies, you have asset managers, portfolio managers, other institutional investors who do portfolio investment. There are unit trust companies, credit rating agencies, a whole gamut of institutions that form part of the capital market. So I think there is a lot of opportunity. Capital market is something I showed the particular side that you're seeing right now. The potential to grow, since we are still not a saturated market, there is potential to grow. And if you look at some of the largest government institutions, all of them finally will reach out to capital markets. They have to come to the capital markets to raise money. They will require funding. Government will require funding, either through debt, private sector will require funding. You will find that all those institutions will ultimately find their way into the market to obtain market-based funding. So the potential to grow is immense, and you have good opportunity. The Port City is another good opportunity. We have already signed up an MOU with the Port City to set up an international stock exchange there. We are going to partner with another international exchange to bring a new dimension into investing in the Port City as well. So there are opportunities like that also which will come our way. So that's the response.
I don't know whether you want to answer this question, Rajiv. The guy is asking, he's a first year student on the master's.
Yeah.
What is your view of pump and dump? If you like to comment.
Pump and dump has been something, a favorite term among many people. It's like this. I would like to take the answer like this. In any industry and in any stock market, you have market offenses. So you have three key market offenses. One is insider trading. Second one is called front running. Third one is about creating a false market or market manipulation, where the pump and dump is categorized. Now, in every market, you have those who will try to abuse the system. There will be insiders who abuse the system, who are in violation of those offenses, which are offenses under the Securities and Exchange Commission Act, which can ultimately result in a jail sentence as well. It's a criminal offense. Then you also have front running, where people who have inside knowledge, like stockbrokers, who can buy shares ahead of you and then dump it on you for a higher price with the knowledge of some inside. Again, it's an offense. And thirdly, will be creating a false market or a market manipulation, where one person or a group of people can get together and attempt to manipulate the share market for their own benefit. Now, that's why we have a regulator who will do the surveillance and the monitoring of that and take action against those who violate. Now, I must also tell you that in every market, you have these offenses, and in every market, you have people violating those rules and regulations and being taken to task. At the SEC, although it's not made public, if you really go through their reports, you will find that they have in fact taken action against some of these offenders, and some of them have been taken to court, some companies have been taken to court, some have been fined, and those actions are ongoing. Even actions against stockbrokers, they may not be very public, but that regulatory process is happening. The rules are in place and it's happening. It may not be very apparent. The other comment I need to make is also, it's not very easy to get a conviction in some of these offenses, because the burden of proof is very high. It's a criminal offense, and when you go to a criminal court, you have to have evidence and the proof beyond all reasonable doubt. So the standard of proof is quite high. As a result, it's not very easy to get a conviction either, and it takes a long time. So I'm not talking in defense of anything that has not been done, but these are the reality. These offenses that we talk about, but the good thing is that regulations are in place, and there is a regulator who is looking into it, and hopefully taking action also against any perpetrator who will engage in this type of activity.
There's a question coming out. How does the current foreign exchange shortage affect the CSC, in particular the capital market in Sri Lanka?
You see, it's like this. A foreigner, when he comes into a country, he will want an easy entry and exit. So he will want to take his money in, invest, and when the foreign investor decides to leave, that investor should be able to very easily take the money out that was brought in, plus any dividends and gains. So that's a fundamental assumption that a foreign investor has. Now, in a situation where there is a foreign exchange crisis, there may be some fears that are being entertained by foreign investors that if they do bring the money, can they take it out? Or if they attempt to take it out, will the price move against me so that I'll end up selling the shares at a lower price? So those are some of the concerns that a foreign investor would have. And thirdly, will the country do a devaluation? If that is so, I rather not come in now, but come after the rupee has been devalued further, because otherwise I will lose out. So if there is a foreign exchange crisis, it may prevent some of our foreign investors from coming in purely because those fears may be entertained. So we need to give that assurance to foreign investors about one, currency devaluation. Secondly, is that you can take out all what you brought in plus your profits without any difficulty. So if we can sort of assure them of those, give those assurances, then you will find that foreigners will keep coming. Of course, even now, despite the sellout, there are inflows as well. There are foreigners who are buying and coming in. It's just that those may be the fears that may be entered, which will have an impact on foreign investors.
You know, one last question I just picked up because time is really short, and I sincerely thank you for staying up so much for this, for the team. It says, why is it that Sri Lanka's stock market is mainly on sentiments and not on fundamentals? How do you, it's almost like, you know, what does it say? Almost like going to the casino.
Yeah. So yeah. So I think it's not as bad as a casino for sure. There is a more scientific approach to how the share prices behave. Well, it's two things. Fundamentally, if you look at a stock, ultimately the value is derived from that company. How well that company is doing, their earnings potential, and all of that, which will go into deciding whether the company is worth investing in, what its future potential is, and the market will give a valuation for that. So at a basic level, we have the fundamentals of the company, which is at the heart of valuing a stock. Now, when you take markets, apart from the fundamentals, are also driven by what we call investor sentiment. That is the confidence that investors have in the company, in the country, in the people who are running the country, and the economy. So a combination of factors. And particularly when you have retail investors investing in the market, that component of sentiment is sort of amplified. They are not as rational as institutional investors or the foreign investors, who will look at the company in a very scientific manner, value the company in a very scientific manner, and then make their investments. They will enter and exit also based on that. But retail investors perhaps will not be that sophisticated to have those tools of measurement. And they will partly look at the company, they will partly look at the sentiment and the confidence and what is happening overall, and be driven. Some type of herd instinct also comes in, which is not a good thing, but it just comes in, where they chase behind certain stocks based on their perception of how well that company would do probably in the future. Social media has had a huge impact on particularly the younger set of investors in Sri Lanka now, and you have opinion leaders giving various opinions, etc. So our job is to constantly educate investors and tell them about the aspect of risk, which I did allude to earlier. Look at the fundamentals of the company. Don't be driven by sentiment. Of course, investor sentiment will always be a factor, and more so in markets like ours, as against a developed market. But I think the important thing to remember is that you need to base your investment judgment on the fundamentals of the company. If you invest in a fundamentally strong company, you will not lose out. But if you invest in a company that is overvalued, then there is a possibility of you suffering a capital loss. So you need to be very, very mindful of that. So it's about timing of the investment. You always buy low and sell high. You don't buy high and sell low and get caught into that cycle, the bad cycle, where sometimes sentiment drives up a price and you feel that that particular stock is moving up, I also must chase behind it. And that's typically sentiment, and you can buy at the wrong price. So I think you need to keep a clear head at all times and always look at the fundamentals of the company. That's why I said you need to invest time as well as your money. You need to study the company that you're going to invest. It's a hard-earned money, whatever it is. And then you need to be very careful in the company that you invest and look at the price of that share. Is it worth it? Will it potentially give me a return? Is this company well managed? Is it well governed? What is the business of the company? What are they going to do in the future? So I think some time has to be invested in studying those companies. And there's a wealth of information that are available, research reports, financial reports that you can study. And all of you all are quite capable of doing your own work. And therefore, that knowledge is important, and understanding the risk is critical. You have to understand that there are risks in the market. Share prices will come down as much as they go up, and you need to be very mindful of that. And therefore, it's very important to understand this risk and then learn how to manage that risk. And there are a lot of tools that you can do, learn that and manage that risk. So that's the response I would really give you.
Thank you, Rajiv. I mean, it's fantastic chatting with you and having you on this program. So are we going to cross 10,000?
Let's hope so. I think eventually, it's a matter of time. I showed you that trajectory of after 2009, the market was at land. We have gone to another level now. And I think it's a progression of the market. It's someday going to hit that. How soon we get there is the question. We as an exchange, as a market operator, would want a sustainable rise in the index so that it's not purely driven by sentiment and a flash in the pan, but we would like the index to move on strong, fundamentally strong companies, and those share prices move up so that it's sustainable and that there is a progression of the market rather than it being kind of a something that happens overnight, and none of us want a crash like what happened in the 2010 period, where there was a bubble and the bubble burst, and all stock markets have experienced that. We had our own experience in 2010. I don't believe that it will happen now, but I think what is important is for the rise to be a sustainable one, which is based on fundamentals like the economic growth of countries, the sustainable growth in the companies, the underlying companies, etc. So that's how I think we should see it.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. That was Rajiv Bandaranaike, CEO of the Colombo Stock Exchange. And it's so beautiful to hear the very mature thinking, Rajiv, and how well you articulated a very hot seat job that you currently do. And Kaushali, over to you.
Thank you very much. And indeed, it is amazing to see that all of you are connecting. I hope my video is coming through. I have a bit of a difficulty on the video. That's all right. So just thank you very much, Mr. Rajiva, for that interesting information sharing, and more than anything, for providing our students the opportunity to make sure that they have exposure to content that we do not find in theories and inside the books and inside many lecture halls. So having said that, we come to the end of another session. And I would like to say thank you to everyone who took part. Of course, thank you for that interesting timing. And we will meet back again in another session. And until then, good night and take care.